Hi, Timo.
Long time no see. Yeah. So we are very pleased to welcome Carole Bernard from GEM, Grenoble Ecole de Management, and Vreux Bruxelles. So she's full professor at GEM and associate researcher in Brussels. And she's going, so she's a regular speaker at Research in Options. And she's going to speak about the rearrangement algorithm and many applications, as I see. Thank you, Carole.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for coming on a Sunday afternoon. Thank you, Jorge, for the invitation. It's my pleasure to be here. And thanks, Lakshit, for the introduction. So I'm going to talk about the rearrangement algorithm and many applications. So indeed, my title is too long to be read. I could have thought a little bit better to make it shorter, but yeah, I thought it's okay. It's a project that I started quite a long time ago. In fact, in 2012, we started to work not on the rearrangement algorithm, but on problems that were related to dependence uncertainty. And actually, the rearrangement algorithm helps to assess model risk and anything that is related to dependence. So I started to work on copulas, work on dependence uncertainty, and at some point, we faced problems that we couldn't solve explicitly, and we developed a methodology that is the rearrangement algorithm, and that has many more applications. So it really opened up our eyes, in some sense, on many things that we thought we couldn't solve, and then that we can now solve using the rearrangement algorithm. among these papers, actually, there are two of them that are more recent applications that will be presented, one on Tuesday by myself, and Luca, my PhD student in Grenoble, is here in the back and will be presenting, in fact, not the rearrangement algorithm, but an alternative method, which is also a numerical approach, using neural networks to find bounds on multi-asset derivatives. Because one of the applications of the rearrangement algorithm is really to price options and then to find bounds on options. And so this is just an alternative numerical method that has advantages and disadvantages, and he will talk about this on Tuesday, I think. Okay, so what are we going to talk of today? First, I'll explain in details about this rearrangement algorithm. I apologize in advance if you have already seen me explaining this algorithm, because this is something I've been working for many years. And then I'll explain some of the applications. The first application that we really worked on was on model risk and model risk assessment when you have difficulties or uncertainty on modeling the dependence between risks. So that's essentially the part two, where we look at uncertainty vis-a-vis the aggregation of risks, and we can compute or assess the model risk of a portfolio when you are uncertain about the dependence between the risks in your portfolio, and you can assess the risks of the variance of the portfolio, the volatility, but also on the value at risk. So I've worked a lot on the value at risk, because at first it's really not linked to the volatility, but actually there's a strong link, and then the methodology that works for the volatility works for value at risk. And it turns out that the rearrangement algorithm is a really good solution to assess risks on a portfolio, getting bounds, risk bounds on the value at risk. So that I'll explain a little bit later what I mean. And then I think I will spend a lot of time on part three, which is where we find, where we think that there's the most potential, is using the rearrangement algorithm, not just to assess model risk to find bounds, but to infer dependence. So what I mean here is essentially a problem where you know the margins, so you have a multidimensional problems. And you know the marginal distribution of each variable. So imagine like a three-dimensional one, you know x1, x2, and x3, you know the marginal distribution. And you know maybe the sum of them, x1 plus x2 plus x3, you can observe it. Or maybe you know the difference between two. You have spread options, and they give you information on the spread. Or maybe you have the spread and the basket option. So you have actually information on combinations of these variables. But you don't know explicitly the dependence. So actually, if you wanted to know exactly the dependence, you would need to know all linear combination. If you take the characteristic function, for instance, you develop it, you will need actually all the distribution of all the linear combination that you could build with your three-dimensional problem to be able to say, I know explicitly what is the dependence. So here we don't say we know the distribution of all linear combination, but just a subset of them. And one of the problems is just when we have information on the sum. So that's just if we know something about only one additional information on the dependence. And this additional information is actually very strong and allows to really capture what kind of dependence is compatible with the distribution of the risks and the distribution of their sum. And this has a lot of applications then in finance. One of the applications I've developed with Oleg Bondarenko is the study of the correlation risk premium. And this one I'll explain a little bit more later. And then another one is the application to multivariate option pricing that I've developed with Steven van der Vel from Brussels and Oleg Bondarenko also. And this one I will talk more on Tuesday. And then the last part, I'm not sure I will have time to talk about it, but this is something I can discuss with some of you if you feel interested in this field. But it's more related to part two. But to go a little bit further, in part two, I'm going to talk about the full dependence uncertainty, which means you know nothing about the dependence. And here, I'm actually adding information on the dependence, but I know still I don't have a perfect information. In some sense, here we add information on the sum, so that gives us some information on the dependence. And here I can add also what I call moment constraints, so then you don't know the distribution. But you know maybe the variance of the sum, maybe you know the skewness, you know some information on the joint moments, or you have information on a subset. So this is also a problem that really can be solved very efficiently with the rearrangement algorithm by adapting it, where now you know information. To me, it's quite practical. It's when you have a data set and you observe a multidimensional phenomenon, you have a lot of information on what happens in normal times. You have a lot of data and so on. Now in the extreme events, maybe you have observed one or maybe you have actually not observed any extreme events. So saying that you know the dependence, so when you build your model, you're actually building a model using your data set, and you can test how your model fits the data set that you have. You can have a super good fit, but still, if I change the model in the tail, where you have no observations, the fit is still as good because you have no observation to say whether it's better or not as good. So there's a lot of uncertainty where you have no information, where you have no observations. And so what we do in this application, we say, what if we actually know really well, we have a data set that allows us to fit a model, but we trust the model where we have enough data. And wherever we don't have data, we just say, okay, we don't trust the model. We don't trust the dependence. And then what can we say if we're interested, for instance, to assess the volatility of the portfolio? Does it help to actually have fitted a model on a subset of the, like, where you have information, or does it not help? And we did that for the volatility, and we did that for the value at risk, which is a tail risk measure. And it turns out that, yes, for volatility, if you want to study the volatility of your portfolio, then the effort to fit a very good model with the information that you have observed, so you observe a lot of data, you fit a model, you construct a model, you try to get the best dependence with this information from the data, and then you get actually very little uncertainty. You could still have unknown dependence in the tail. It won't affect too much the volatility of your portfolio. It affects a bit, but it doesn't affect it too much. When I say not too much, it's relative to what happens if you actually study the value at risk. So imagine you're interested in the value at risk of the portfolio at 99.95%, which is sometimes what the regulators impose. And then what happens? You have your data, and then you spend months to try to fit the best model and so on. And then we say, okay, we trust the model where we have data, and then we delete everything else from the model. We just say we're not sure about the dependence in the tail. And then we shake the model. We try to find what is the maximum value at risk, what is the minimum value at risk I would get if I trust my model only in this small part where I have data. And then what we find is actually the information that you get from this model that you fitted is almost irrelevant. So it's almost as if you have no information on the model and you just are in the set where you have full dependence uncertainty, which means I know my marginal risk, but I know nothing on the dependence. So that actually means that if you're really interested in what happens in the tail, then you need data or you need to trust your model in the tail. Otherwise, it's actually irrelevant to spend time to fit a good model outside the tail. So this is the story here, and I spend a bit more time because I'm not sure I will have time to actually cover it later. Okay, so let's talk about the rearrangement algorithm. It's a small algorithm to solve a problem that's actually very easy to state. The assumptions are simple. We have n risks, and then we know the marginal distribution of each of them, and we don't know how they interact. We don't know the correlation matrix. We don't know anything about the interaction between these variables. And I'm interested in the sum. So you could do a weighted sum. You could do other combination, but I'm going to take the simplest case, which is just the sum of the risks, so a simple aggregation function. And I take a function of this sum, which could be the square, for instance. I take a convex function of the sum. I want to know what is the maximum and the minimum of this convex function. If you think in terms of the variance of your portfolio, it just means what's the maximum variance and minimum variance I can get if I know only the margins and I don't know anything about the dependence. Two-dimensional case, super easy. Maximum variance, maximum risk is obtained when the two risks are comonotonic, which means that they move in the same direction. So you take U a uniform, any uniform, and then when you apply the quantile function, you actually get some risk that has distribution F1, some risk that has distribution F2, and these two are comonotonic. They move in the same direction. They have maximum correlation. If they were normal, they would just have correlation 1. And then the opposite case, when you have two dimensions, if you want to minimize the variance of your portfolio, I'm not like teaching very complicated stuff, you just take two risks that move in opposite direction. Negative correlation is good for minimizing the variance. You try as negative as possible. Problem, what happens when n is bigger than 2? So if you have more than two risks and you want to maximize your variance, that's very easy. You put everything moving in the same direction. And that maximizes the risks, and that's what happens here. But when you are looking at the minimum, then you have trouble. Actually, this lower bound doesn't exist in theory, so it's not explicit. And there's no one structure. So here, this is the comonotonic structure. You can construct it whatever the n is and whatever the marginal distribution are. So you always can construct this dependence function. You always have this upper bound that is explicit. When n is bigger than 3, you cannot find this minimum. And it's quite intuitive because you want to have negative correlation. And in three dimensions already, this is complicated. Because if you take x1 and x2 and you move and you want to make them as negative as possible, x1 moves up, x2 goes down. 1 and 3, you want to make them as negative as possible. X1 moves up, x3 goes down. And what happened? X2 and x3 go down together. So actually, by making x1 and x2 and x1 and x3 negatively correlated, you create positive correlation in the two last variables. So how to make as negative correlation as possible? And there is a concept that is relatively recent that was introduced by Rudu Wang and a colleague from one of his colleagues from Beijing. Rudu Wang is a professor at the University of Waterloo and was my colleague when I was there. And he did, this is actually his PhD thesis. During his PhD thesis, he introduced a new concept that really changed the way people were looking at this problem, because they were looking at finding these minimum bounds using duality, and they were finding constructions that were not explicit. But this is an explicit construction of this minimum, this lower bound. And the problem is, this minimum sometimes doesn't exist. Yes? So in some cases it exists, and in some cases there's, is there an example where there's no minimum? There's no, yeah, so you see here, for any convex function, this is the copula that maximize, the commutative copula maximize, and the anti-monotonic copula minimize. If you take here three dimension, commutative copula maximize for any convex function. If you look at the minimum, the copula that minimize the problem exists, because I think it's still the existence problem is not a problem, but it's different depending on the convex function. So if you minimize the square, or if you minimize the exponential of the sum, you would get a different copula that minimize the expectation. That's why we say the Fréchet-Hebding lower bound. The Fréchet-Hebding lower bound doesn't depend on the, it's just an order on copulas. It's the minimum for. Yeah, there's no solution that works for all F, or all convex function. Yes, I think there is, but it's hard to find. And there is one case where you can find one that doesn't depend on F, and that's this case. So what is this case? This case is you find a dependence between the n variables such that the sum is constant. So if you think about the variance, what is the minimum variance? It has to be more than zero, and if the variance of a constant is actually zero. And so if you can find a dependent structure such that the sum is constant, then for any convex function, the minimum is this copula. So the case where you can find complete mixability, so you can find a dependence in n dimension such that the sum is constant, then you have a minimum that works for any convex function. And so finding this dependence is not easy, and then sometimes actually you can prove that it doesn't exist. So then you know for sure that the lower bound will depend on which convex function you're looking at. But it exists in some restricted case. It exists, for instance, for normal distribution. So if you take N01 distribution, you take all normal 01 distribution, then for any N, you can find a structure such that it's actually equal to zero. So if you take two risks, it's easy. X1 plus X2, you just take X2 equal minus X1. For three risks, it's already not completely obvious, but actually you just have to work. The equation is relatively easy to do with the correlation matrix, for instance. You can find a dependent structure in the multivariate normal such that X1 plus X2 plus X3 is identically equal to zero. And then you can do that for 4, 5, and then play easily. Like if it's completely mixable for n equal 2 and n equal 3, then you can construct n equal 4 by saying 2 and 2, n equal 5 by 3 and 2, and so on. So you could really build a dependent structure at a higher n. But the complication is really to find this complete mixability. And it won't be completely mixable in dimension 2 unless you are symmetric. Because x1 plus x2 being a constant means that x1 is equal to minus x2 if you just take an expectation equal to zero, then you would just have the opposite. And so you need a symmetric distribution already to have two, to be completely mixable with n equal to. And so there are restricted cases. It also shows that if you have you work on distribution that have a decreasing density on an interval, a finite interval, then you can also show that it's always that there exists a copula such that it's completely mixable. But there are cases also where it's not completely mixable, and then you cannot find such a structure. Then, okay, if it's not completely mixable, how to be as close as possible to this situation? And that's where the rearrangement algorithm comes in. It was already it was proposed in 2012 by Puccetti and Ruschendorf, and it actually builds on some earlier work of Ludger Ruschendorf. I will give you a bit of history about this this algorithm. And the idea is simply that you take your n marginal distribution with no assumptions on the marginal distribution, except that you know them, that they are explicitly known, and you look for copulas that minimize this thing for any f convex. And you look for this minimum, and of course, if it depends on the f, we'll see that the algorithm doesn't depend on the f, so that's why the algorithm is actually only a heuristic, and then I will show when it works, and then actually it always works approximately, but it doesn't converge for sure to the global minimum. Yeah. Yes. Yes, exactly. Exactly, yeah. So you just look for a joint distribution in n dimension, and then it's equal to a constant almost surely. And this constant has to be the sum of the expectation, in fact. And it just has to be, because the expectation on the left has to be equal to the expectation on the right. So the constant has to be the sum of the expectations. So more questions? Solving for the minimum variance, for instance, and then, in fact, you could put here, instead of variance, expectation of any f convex of the sum, it would still be the same algorithm. So that's why, in some sense, this minimum depends on f in general, but the algorithm is actually looking for a structure that is as completely mixable as possible, and will not depend on really why, like, it doesn't really depend on the variance. So the way it works is you take your marginal distribution that you know, and you discretize them in n equiprobable values. So f1 is just discretized by n values, x2 is discretized by n values, xd is discretized by n values, and the values in each column are the things that you cannot change. So each column represents one variable, and these values are what is fixed, what is the input, and will not be changed. The only thing that you could change is the dependence. And how do you see the dependence? It's just the order of the numbers in each column. If I change the order in each column, I actually change the dependence between x1, x2, and xd, but I don't change anything else. I don't change the marginal distribution. And so the idea is just to rearrange each column so that after rearranging the variance of the sum, so if you sum the values by rows, so the row sums, the variance is minimized. So ideally, you want all the row sums to be constants. Now, if you try to do it just like brute force, you would just try any possible rearrangement of this matrix, and there are many of them. And actually, it's very long to solve it. And if n is big, that quickly it cannot be solved in a minute. And there are no algorithms that can solve this problem in polynomial complexity. So NP complete problem, it just means that you cannot solve it with a polynomial complexity algorithm. But the rearrangement algorithm actually aims exactly at rearranging, at solving this problem. And the rearrangement algorithm is polynomial complexity. So actually, it's a very fast algorithm. It aims at solving this problem, but we know it cannot solve it always because it's NP-complete. But it works in practice always. So I would just, to me, it always works. So it's indeed, in theory, it doesn't work always, but in practice, it actually always works. You just discretize enough, and then you'll find that it converges, and it converges to a solution that is a sensible solution. So to illustrate how the rearrangement algorithm works, I'm going to take a matrix that, indeed, you can solve very easily, because in folder, we have four observations that have all probability 1 over 4. So you can imagine that x1 takes these four values with probability 1 over 4, x2 the four other values, x3 the four other values, and then interaction among the columns is just the dependence, and we want to find which dependence minimize the variance of the sum. How people were doing that before the complete mixability and before the rearrangement algorithm. So the first related problem in the literature is actually a problem that was solved, I didn't put the reference. So these ones from 1984, so this was a problem in the 1980s, partition problem. The idea is you have positive integers, and you want to partition these integers into two categories such that the sum of the elements in S1 is more or less equal to the sum of the elements in S2. The difference is minimized. So you have these five numbers, and optimally, they would be solved so that 7 and 8 go together, the sum is 15, and these three go together, the sum is 15. So for that, they developed a greedy algorithm, and then the idea is you order your numbers, you take the biggest number, you put it in one category, the second biggest, you put it in the second category, and then you iterate, and each time you put the number in the category that has the smaller sum. And this more or less works, but actually it doesn't work perfectly here. You could see that with the greedy algorithm, you would not get the optimal split from the partition. But that's a heuristic, that's how they would solve the problem. So that's, you just order them, you put 8 and 7, and then the 6 goes with the 7 because it has the lowest sum. Then this one has a bigger sum, so you put the 5 and the 4 here, and then at the end, the sums are not equal, but are roughly closer. And then if you have a big list, it has been shown that this algorithm was good. And actually, it was published in Mathematics of Operational Research, which is quite a good journal. So the idea was really just to, it's also called actually the assembly line crew scheduling problem, how to rearrange elements within columns of a matrix such that variability among the row sums becomes minimum. So this is the problem that we are looking at. And it's a bit like this partition problem, but now in higher dimension. And the greedy algorithm was also adapted for this higher dimension. The idea was you take your first column, and then the second column, you would arrange it so that the numbers are anti-monotonic with the sum of the previous numbers. So you want the sums to be the lowest number goes with the biggest sum, the biggest number goes with the smallest sum. So here you have only one column, so the sum is 3, so 3 and 4. And then you do this, the next step, so 5, 7, and 7. So 5 is the smallest sum, so you take the biggest number, you put 5 here, 3 here, 0. And then you get something that, again, is close to being lower in variability, at least compared to 12, 9, and 6. So that's how the greedy algorithm works. But there's a way to improve it. And it was already improved, in fact, in 1983 by Ludger Ruschendorf. And that's really, so the rearrangement algorithm was hidden in the literature with this problem of assembly line crew scheduling. And he just noticed that if you want to beat this algorithm that only goes iteratively from the biggest, across the columns, you could actually do a smarter algorithm that sorts the elements of each column in reverse order of the raw sums of all other columns. And why this one works better? Because when you do this on the same matrix, you actually achieve 999, and you're actually doing the rearrangement algorithm. Why it works better? It's actually the way the rearrangement algorithm works is to take a column and rearrange it as negatively correlated as the sum of the others. And so I'll show you why, and then we'll explain why it actually works and why it could only minimize the variance and then hopefully convert to the minimum variance. So just to go back to my original problem, if I have the three variables x1, x2, and x3, so it's clear if I rearrange the columns, I have an effect on the dependence, I have no effect on the margins. If I order them in a comnotonic way, so I put all the big numbers together and all the small numbers together, then I get the comnotonic scenarios, perfect correlation that is positive, we maximize the variance. And now, how to minimize the variance? We get inspired to the case of two dimension. So in two dimension, when you want to minimize the variance between x1 and x2, you put x1 negatively correlated to x2, as negatively correlated as possible, anti-monotonic. So that's why I put an A here, just to say anti-monotonic. In D dimension, what do you do? You do exactly the same by looking at saying that you have you're interested in the variable k, and you take all the others and you put them in a category, which is the j's that are different from k, and the sum of the n variables can be written as xk plus the sum of the others. And this one, if I want to minimize the variance of the portfolio, I need to make each k as negatively correlated as possible compared to the sum of the others. And that's really the spirit of the algorithm, just taking each column one at a time and making it anti-monotonic with the sum of the other columns. And so when you apply it, it's very simple. X2 plus X3, I calculate it here, so 10, 5, 2, and 0. And then I look at my X1, and I put the biggest number in front of the smallest sum, just to make them as negatively correlated as possible. So I put the 6 here, the 4 goes with 2, the 1 goes with 5, and the 0 with 10. And so I have a first step, and then I do the same with the second column, and then with the third column. And then I do it again and again, because then I can go back to the first column and do it again. And after some iteration, and then here it's just after 3 iterations, you actually get a sum that, if you're lucky, is exactly like this. So x1 plus x2 plus x3 is exactly constant. So that means then you have solved the problem. And then this one is completely mixable. This one minimizes the variance, problem solved. Now, sometimes what you find is something here that's almost completely mixable. So it's not constant, but it is like within epsilon. So when you do it with normal distribution, we know it's completely mixable. But when you discretize, of course, the problem becomes a little bit more tricky, and then maybe it's not even completely mixable exactly. But you'll find like variation here, maybe of the order of 10 minus 5 or 10 minus 6. So you could find like very small variation on the values here, and then so you're almost completely mixable. And so the question is like how far you are from the optimum, if the optimum exists, and do we find this optimum if it exists? And so one thing that we've developed from this algorithm is to improve it. The first improvement was relatively easy, and then actually ended up being key to solve the problem to infer dependence. So without this improvement, actually the rearrangement algorithm is not precise enough to solve for the minimum that helps to infer dependence. So for the application that we develop in finance, we do need the block rearrangement algorithm. Whereas for the application on value at risk, which are the applications that were developed by Puccetti, Ruschendorf, and Paul Embrecht, for this application, the rearrangement algorithm works already super well. So it's not a big improvement for them, at least in practice. But it does improve a lot for us when we were looking for the dependence. So how to improve the algorithm? It's simply, if you have more than three variables, you think exactly the same way. So you want the variance of the sum to be minimized, so you take every colon and you want to be as negatively correlated to the sum of the others. So instead of taking one colon in isolation, I actually just split my colons into two subsets. And I want the sum in one subset to be as negatively correlated as the sum in the other subset. So this is the idea. The variance is minimum if the correlation between any subset, the sum over this subset, and the sum over the complementary set is minimized, so the correlation is as negative as possible. So these two sums are as negatively correlated as possible. And so what it means now we have more conditions we can check, and so maybe the algorithm, the rearrangement algorithm converge, stops, but by looking at subsets of two and two, for instance, we can further improve the problem, and then we'll converge to something that has a lower variance. So the idea is always to find some operation to do on the matrix so that we minimize, we go a little bit lower, so we minimize the variance. At each step, we actually do decrease the variance strictly. So anytime you do a strict swap, and then you really decrease the correlation, you also decrease the variance. So anytime your algorithm like goes down, 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 you have a finite number of moves that you can do because you have a finite number of numbers in your matrix. And zero is the lower bound. So at some point, the algorithm is going to stop. And all the operation that you could do, you cannot go smaller. So this is just an additional thing to do. And when you have like a lot of variables, so if n is like 100 variables, and you start to look at all the possible partition into two subsets, if n is very big, then you have a lot of them, and then 2 at the power n minus 1 minus 1. And so you cannot do all this move. And then we do just a random sample of this partition. If n is equal to 10 or less than 10, you can actually implement it by doing all the possible partition into two subsets. And for instance, for now, for the application that we've done, we've worked up to 10 dimensions, and then we always work with the block RA that solves the problem using all the blocks into two partitions of, let's say, 10 variables, so partition 5 and 5, 4 and 6, 3 and 7, and so on. So each time you do the partition, and then you check whether the sums are anti-monotonic. If they are not, you rearrange the matrix. Each time you rearrange the matrix, because they were not anti-monotonic, you strictly decrease the variance. So you make it smaller and smaller, and then hopefully you get the minimum. And so once you cannot improve anymore, then you output the matrix, and otherwise you just go again and again. And indeed, one thing that we've done in parallel is to develop this new multivariate measures. So correlation, when you want one number that tells you are these variables negatively correlated? If you have two variables, you calculate the correlation. If it's minus one, you're super happy because you can say it's the minimum correlation. If it's not minus one, then you have to check the margins to know what is the minimum correlation. But you could, with one number, have an idea of whether they are positively correlated, negatively correlated. If you have a three-dimensional problem, already this is a problem. Because if I want just one number that tells me are these three variables positively or negatively dependent? I don't know, because if you do a correlation matrix, then you already have a lot of numbers. So how to summarize the information with one number? It's not, there are many ways to do it, and then a lot of people have tried to develop multivariate measures. But we like this one because this one allows to take any measures of dependence in two dimensions and move it to n dimensions. idea is simple. So phi is just a measure of dependence between x1 and x2. So it could be correlation between x1 and x2, for instance. And then if you have n dimensional problem, you know that you cannot use this measure of dependence unless you have a two-dimensional problem. So you partition this n-dimensional problem into two subsums, and you calculate the correlation of these two subsums. You sum over all possible partition, you divide by the number of partition, and you get the average value of these pairs. And it turns out that if you take, for instance, Candelstow or Spearman's rho, if you have anti-monotonic variables, Candelstow or Spearman's rho will be equal to minus one. So if you apply the block rearrangement algorithm, and each time you have two blocks and you make them anti-monotonic, what you have is that the correlation between these two sums is actually minus one. Or the Candelstow between these two sums is minus one. So on average, it is minus one. And so a necessary condition, because we know to get this minimum variance, we need, this is just a necessary condition, we need that every column is anti-monotonic with the sum of the others. It's not sufficient. So we'll have many structures such that each column is anti-monotonic with the sum of the others that are actually not minimum variance. But we're for sure, we know that if there is one column that is not anti-monotonic, we can apply the rearrangement algorithm and decrease strictly the variance. So one condition, which is a necessary condition to be at the minimum variance, must be that the correlation is minus one between all these partitions, and so that on average is minus one, and so minus one is this multivariate risk measure, and you can use it as a stopping rule. Because if it's almost minus one, if you're doing it in very high dimension, you could actually stop. Now, the problem is the evaluation. You do need to evaluate this sum, and this sum has a lot of elements. So then you can do it. You can do it also with a subset of this sum by taking a random subset, and then you'll get an average that is not exactly this, but just an estimator that is not exactly this sum. So two observations that we have with the rearrangement algorithm or the block rearrangement algorithm. There are many local minima, and they won't be at the minimum variance, but what we find is that they are always very close to it. So when the algorithm converges and it's not to the local, to the global minimum variance, it's still very small. So you don't make a big mistake if you're just minimizing the variance to take something that is not the global minimum, but just the local minimum. And if you do the block RA, then you always have a variance that is 10 to 100 times smaller. So it actually works much better than the rearrangement algorithm, but it's slower. So then you have to balance efficiency and the speed of the algorithm and the accuracy that you want. Giovanni Puccetti, who is kind of the founder of this rearrangement algorithm, has actually put a website where he puts MATLAB R codes, and then I prefer MATLAB, so I often code more using MATLAB, and then I have MATLAB codes that are equivalent to the R codes that are posted online. How to apply it now in the case of a portfolio? So imagine that you have a d-dimensional portfolio. You have your x1, x2, xd. You know the margin for these d risks. And you want to know what's the minimum volatility, what's the maximum volatility of my portfolio if I know only the margins. Maximum volatility is obtained with common tonicity, and you can just show it's the sum of the volatilities. So that's the maximum you can get. So if you take 20 normal risks, you could just say, OK, the volatility is at least, will always be less than 20. The problem is the minimum volatility is actually zero. Because if you take 20 normals, it's completely mixable. So if you took x2 equal minus x1, x4 equal minus x3, x6 minus x5, and so on, you actually get a sum that's exactly equal to zero. And so that's completely mixable. And OK, so dependence uncertainty is huge in the sense that If in your portfolio you know only the margins and you know they are normal and you don't know anything on your correlation, then okay, you can just say the volatility is between 0 and 20, which is not very insightful, at least in practice. For a mathematician, you're always happy when you find bounds. But for somebody working in practice, if I tell him, oh, your volatility is between 0 and 20, then it doesn't tell him much. Especially if 20 is really the maximum volatility you can get, and then you know it's just too wide, and then you need additional information. So all this work, I mean, is nice. It allows to find bounds, but has been a bit criticized in practice for finding bounds that are not so useful because they are too wide, because you assume you know nothing on the dependence. For Bernoulli distribution, you can also solve it. The minimum and the maximum can be found. The minimum is actually obtained, so because the Bernoulli distribution is a case where it's relatively easy to see it in a matrix. I should have put a matrix of 0 and 1, but you could easily, if you have a matrix with only 0 and 1, like imagine a Bernoulli distribution, so your when you look at this kind of matrix, your x1 takes two values, 0 or 1, your x2 takes two values, 0 or 1, and you want to rearrange the values so that the sum is as constant as possible. Actually, it's easy to think that you will put the 1 and the 0 so that you have either 6 or 7. Like depending on the average that you want to get, you could get, if the average is 6.5, you will get some 6 and some 7. And you can always twist the dependence to get that. And so the result is actually explicit to find the bounds, the dependence as well. So this is relatively easy to guess, at least for Bernoulli distribution. But apart from normal and Bernoulli distribution, it's hard. And you actually, unless you run the algorithm, it's not intuitive what you should get to get the minimum variance. And so when you have arbitrary distribution, you just apply the RA, or the block RA, and then you find something. It gives you the variance of the volatility, the variance of the sum, and it's minimized with the output of the algorithm, or at least almost minimized. And in practice, we really think it, like the fact that it's, if the minimum is 0 and you find 10 minus 5, it really doesn't matter in practice. So the algorithm just works. And then that's what we were a little bit like working with it. We just realized that yes, it's an heuristic. Yes, it cannot solve the problem exactly, but it does solve it really, really close. And these structures that are such that all columns and all blocks are anti-monotonic with the sum of the others are such that they are not so far from your global minimum. So there are many of them, but still they are not that far from each other. And so if you have one, then likely you find actually a minimum that is very close to the global minimum. So this is the end of the first part where I was talking about the rearrangement algorithm and then how to use it for variance bounds, which is kind of the reason why it was developed. And then, Luger, Ruschendorf, Giovanni Puccetti, and Paul Embrecht work together and show we're able to find that it has also potential to help not just to find bounds on variance problem, but also bounds on value at risk. And quantify model risk in practice, when model risk on portfolio estimation, when you aggregate risks. So what is the problem with value at risk? Similar to variance, if I give you information on risks, if I give you information on the dependence, so I give you the full joint distribution, and I tell you what's the quantile, what's the value at risk of your portfolio, you can just compute it. And you find one number, fine. If you know nothing on the dependence, or just partially the dependence, you cannot compute the value at risk. Actually, you cannot compute anything. You cannot compute the variance. You have some uncertainty on it, and you get a range of possible values. And so we say that there is model risk, And so that's the idea that is behind is we want to calculate the risk of a sum, and we know the margins. The risk we need to calculate it with the variance or the variate risk. We know sometimes more than the margin. Actually, we could fit the multivariate distribution, and we could compute this rho s, but we want to know how much model risk we make, how wrong we can be, depending on the assumption that we trust, and depending on how good we are in our fit. So formally, the problem becomes, if I assume that I'm interested in the volatility, the variance of the portfolio, then I'm interested what is the maximum and minimum variance, given that I take this minimum and maximum over all possible joint distribution that agree with the available information. And then everything is about what is the available information. If I know only the margins and I'm interested in the variance, okay, then the rearrangement algorithm solves the problem for the minimum and the maximum we know how to solve it. Now, what if I know more, or what if it's not the variance? And so variance is the problem solved. Actually, any problem that is consistent with convex order, so any expectation of a convex sum, for instance, would work the same way. So the RA would work. And where the RA worked, and it was a bit surprising, was actually the value at risk. So the idea, and why it's actually surprising that the, yeah? It just, so you mean anything consistent with convex order? The expectation of a convex sum. So if you take, you want to minimize the expectation of, so if I put, if this is my objective function, f of x1 plus xn, then I know to minimize it that a necessary condition is that actually my x1 is anti-monotonic to the sum of x2 plus xn. And x2 is anti-monotonic with the other sum. And also x1 plus x2, for instance, is anti-monotonic to x3 plus xn. So all these are necessary conditions. So I have like a lot of these necessary conditions. And the block RA, or the rearrangement algorithm, works. The rearrangement algorithm works only with this type of condition. The block RA consider also conditions where you have more than one variables. But what is specific about the block rearrangement algorithm is that it really finds a structure such that all sums over two partitions, like a partition in two blocks, are anti-monotonic. So all these conditions, whatever block you take, so that's why I write it as over pi, and then I have the complementary set. This one is anti-monotonic with this one. And so the block array converges to a situation like this, which is a necessary condition for the dependence to minimize this. Except that there is no unique copula that has this property. If it's not convex, it doesn't work. It works in the opposite direction. What's the answer to this? It's the order. I think it's linked to the submodularity property. So we need some modular property, and then I think this one, it's like if f is convex and you take the sum and you look at this one as a multivariate function, you need the convexity of f for this function to be submodular or supermodular, depending if you maximize or minimize, and that's what you need then to have the order on the copula that is related to the order on this. So you do need this convexity on F, that's for sure. There are no, like, except this greedy algorithm that we found. Or you can do the linear programming. Maybe. I've worked on this. Okay. So you say Yano-Bloy and his co-authors. Okay. Then. And they've developed an algorithm to solve this kind of problem? Probably not as fast as this one. Okay. Okay. I have to check, but I don't know if it applies exactly here, but probably. I actually don't know. Yeah. So we worked to solve this problem that we had on the variance to move it to value at risk, and value at risk it's actually not intuitive at all. The fact that this algorithm is helpful. The first reason why it's not intuitive is that there are two problems, maximum value at risk and minimum value at risk. Both of them are actually not related. It doesn't have the same property as a convex function of a sum. And so this condition that we have here doesn't maximize or doesn't minimize the value at risk. So we need to think differently. Maximum value at risk is not caused by the commutonic scenarios. You have things that are more risky when you look at the value at risk. You can have a higher value at risk by going beyond the commutonic scenarios. It's not because you have high correlation that you have high value at risk. And what we were able to prove is that maximum value at risk is obtained when the variance is minimum in the tail, or when actually the tail is minimum in convex order. So the RA, the rearrangement algorithm, is used now only in the tails, and then I'll explain how to do it. So what was already existing in the literature, again, this was a problem that was exciting in the 1980s, and then there's nothing that happened for another 10 years before, almost 20 years, before it was picked up again. First problem was, you don't know anything on the dependence, and you know everything on the margins. How to solve the maximum or minimum quantile of a sum when you have two risks? This was solved, and then they find explicit formula. And there are several papers that works in two dimensions, so the problem was already not so intuitive, and then depending on the distribution, they were not finding a structure that was always the same. And then in dimension three, then the problem remained unsolved except with very special cases or using duality and using approximation until 2012, where Puccetti and Ruschendorf proposed their algorithm, and then the paper by Emresh, Puccetti and Ruschendorf, where they really applied these bounds to calculate the value at risk. So, value at risk in two dimensions. Why the comotonicity doesn't maximize value at risk? So value at risk is a quantile. So maybe I should just define what I mean by this. So I think the inf of the x such that the probability of s bigger than x is bigger than q. Is bigger or smaller? Look here, 1 minus q. masks, less than one mask queue. Probably is the same. Okay. And so that's just a quantile function. So if it's continuous, it's just the inversion of your survival function of your distribution function, such that it's exactly equal to Q, that the distribution function is exactly equal to Q. And so what happens if you have uniform distribution? You take two uniform, and you're looking at two comonotonic uniform. Evaluate risk of the comonotonic sum is actually the sum of the evaluate risk, and it's just 2 times Q. One thing that we know is that the evaluate risk is always smaller than the tail evaluate risk. So the tail evaluate risk of a variable is just the average in the tail. So I go in the tail and I average the evaluate risk. So I take all the evaluate risk in the tail and I average them. And so, of course, if I take the evaluate risk at Q, it must be smaller than the tail evaluate risk, because it's just one number, and it's actually the smallest number in the tail. So one thing we're sure is that the evaluate risk is always smaller than the tail evaluate risk. Tail evaluate risk, we know actually that the maximum tail evaluate risk is obtained for comonotonic, in the comonotonic case. And so if you average the numbers here, so you would get 1 plus Q over 2. The average numbers between Q and 1, so given that the evaluate risk is some numbers between Q and 1, so the average evaluate risk, 1 plus Q. Oh, yeah, because it's 2P. Yes. I forgot the 2 here. So you average 2Q in the tail, you actually get 1 plus Q. And because Q is between 0 and 1, 2Q is always smaller than 1 plus Q. So the comonotonic scenario is always smaller than the tail evaluate risk of the comonotonic scenario. And this one is actually the biggest possible values for the tail evaluate risk. And we know actually the evaluate risk is always going to be smaller than this number. So now the question is, can we find a dependence such that the evaluate risk of the sum is equal to the maximum tail evaluate risk that is possible to achieve? And the answer is yes, if you do this very strange structure. So you take your two uniform, you make them whatever you want, actually below Q, below the level Q. You can put them comonotonic, but actually you can put whatever you want below, it doesn't matter. But what matters is what happens in the tail. In the tails, you make them anti-monotonic. And in this case, so if you look at the evaluate risk here, it's, so the value is actually always equal to 1 plus Q in the tail. So the evaluate risk is 1 plus Q. And this 1 plus Q is exactly equal to the tail evaluate risk of a comonotonic sum, which is the maximum tail evaluate risk that you can get. So you know you can't get bigger than that. So that's actually the maximum you can get. And so this is the structure that maximizes evaluate risk. And when you understand this in two dimensions, then you understand where the rearrangement algorithm is going to play a role. Because what we want here is actually that when you sum x1 and x2, you get a constant in the sum, in the tail. You want something that's always equal to 1 plus q. So that's constant in the tail. So you add up two variables and you want a constant. That's exactly complete mixability. And then you can extend this at higher dimension. So what happens? You have your evaluate risk. You have the average evaluate risk for the comonotonic sum. And you want to find a structure so that it's always equal to this value, so that it's constant in the tail. Does it exist? In two dimensions, for uniform, it does. If it's a symmetric distribution, it does. And if it's not symmetric, then sometimes it doesn't exist. And you can find the same way. So maximum value at risk will be the obtained by a dependence that is such that when you add up things in the tail, it's as constant as possible. And the lower value at risk, the minimum value at risk, is obtained when you sum, it's actually constant also. Because this is this lower tail value at risk is also the minimum value that you could get. And so if you find a structure so that it's always equal to this value, then that's it. You have your minimum value at risk obtained. So these bounds A and B turns out to be bounds on value at risk that always work. They are analytical bounds. And you can use the rearrangement algorithm to find the dependent structure that match that. So that is as, so if you find a dependent structure that is such that you're always equal to B in the tail, then you actually have found a dependent structure such that the value at risk is equal to B, and so it's maximized. If you find a dependent structure that is such that it's constant in the lower tail, you have find the minimum value at risk. So you can really play with the rearrangement algorithm by just taking the lowest values and playing with them, or the highest values and playing with them. So this was done in these two papers that of Ludger and Paul Embrecht and Giovanni Puccetti. And so the idea is very simple. You order your values. You take all the big values. And then you reorder, you apply the rearrangement algorithm just in the tail, in this small subset that has probability 1 minus q, and you find a way to make it as constant as possible. And so here you look at the average value in the tail. So when you look at the average, it's like 20 in this case. So you would want to have always 20. And it turns out that if you rearrange them using the rearrangement algorithm, you do find a sum that is always equal to 20. So in this case, it is completely mixable, and that's exactly how you obtain the maximum value at risk, which is obtained with 20. And so now when people say, oh, high correlation is bad for value at risk, is risky, this is actually wrong, because what we have here is low correlation. So if you have negative correlation in the tail, you actually maximize your risk. So if you were to construct a dependence between risks that would look like this, it's actually much more dangerous than a dependence that would be just be comonotonic. And so now the problem is that this tail, if you take Q equal 99.5%, or 99.95%, which is sometimes recommended by the regulators, then in this set, you have almost no observation. And so depending if your assumption in a like most regular model has some positive correlation in the tail, so it's closer to the comonotonic set. But if you really want to stress the model, you will need to take the tail and then make them negative. Negative correlation in the tail. And that's where you get your maximum value at risk and the worst possible situation. So in higher dimensions, so I've shown you the graph with two dimensions, but of course the algorithm works in higher dimension. So what if you have 20 normal distribution and you want to find the bounds on value at risk at 95% or at 99.95%, you apply the rearrangement algorithm in the lower tail or in the upper tail, and you were able, you can actually find the numbers. And these numbers are actually very, you can run the algorithm many times. You would find different structures. Always these structures that you find have this property that each column is antimonotonic with the sum of the others. They are not exactly the same structures. They are not exactly the same values. But they are like the numbers that change are not like the first two digits, like are the numbers afterwards. And so that's also why and even using just the rearrangement algorithm, not using the block rearrangement algorithm, the methodology is actually very stable. Even though each time you run the algorithm, you would converge to a structure that has the right properties, so that has these properties, but that is actually every time a bit different. So it's not exactly the same value. And so, yeah, this paper was definitely a really nice paper, very well motivated, but the dependence and the criticism that came immediately from the practitioners is that, again, these bonds are completely meaningless because, in fact, they tell nothing about the risks. It actually what it tells you is like if you put 20 normal together and you're thinking value at risk is sometimes interpreted as capital requirements, imagine these are millions. What it says either you need no capital requirement, it's negative, so you would need nothing, or you need $70 million capital requirement. So if you go to your boss and you say, oh, I have a risk, but the capital requirements are any number between 0 and 70, I can find a model that actually fits my risk, just that I don't know anything about the dependence, so it's just one of these models. Then you actually really have too much uncertainty. So then we worked on this paper and we tried to extend it by adding additional information. And that's where we were kind of disappointed to say, even if you add a lot of information coming from a fitted model, unless you really have assumption on what happens in the tail, if you don't have assumption and you don't make ad hoc assumption with data that you have observed, it's not enough to actually set up the tail. So you can have a lot of information coming from a fitted model. You will still get bounds that are very close to this. So yeah, adding information on dependence need to be done in a really ad hoc or expert's way so that you say, okay, in the tail, I know it's going to be comonotonic because of economic reasons. And then you can bound the value at risk a little bit better. But if you know nothing or you don't want to make assumptions that are not coming from data, then you cannot improve these bounds. So it will just tell you that working at the 99.95% is maybe not very smart. At least you can't assess the risk in an accurate way in this way. And of course, so this was also motivated by some sentences that we found in the Basel Committee in 2013, where he was saying that if you take two banks with identical risks and you apply some rules, you should arrive to the same amount of risk-weighted assets, and two banks with different risk profiles should produce risk numbers that are different proportionally to the difference in risks. Now, the problem is if I have information from these two banks that are the same, but these two banks have their own framework that fits perfectly to this information, but change their model in the tail where they have no data. So the fit is as good, but still the numbers that they will find are completely different. So we do have a problem when we look at this value at risk at very high level. Okay, so maybe actually, I should stop now. That's a more natural way to stop on this section. So we've done these bonds on value at risk, bonds on variance, and we added dependence. We've done a few experiments, and then each time we actually came to a conclusion that whatever information that you add, the bounds are still too wide. And so for now, we don't have a solution to actually make these applications really meaningful and useful for the industry, because we can only say that the model risk, as soon as you talk about dependence, the model risk is big and we don't know how to reduce it. But the rearrangement algorithm has also other applications where we think it's much more promising, which is to use them when you know marginals and information on the sum or information on weighted sums. So this is an additional information on dependence, and it turns out that using the rearrangement algorithm, you're able to find the dependence, and then it solves many problems that are a bit more relevant for the industry. Are there questions for this first part? Okay, then small break.
How long is the break, Georgia? All right.
Okay, so 20 minutes.
Let's do 20 minutes. Thank you, Carol.
Thank you.